May you live in interesting times. Most of us probably know this as a supposed Chinese curse. But I'm going to argue here today that we live in the most interesting of times, and that this can be a real blessing. Here's one way of visualizing the extraordinary times that we live in. Starting with the Industrial Revolution, which was initially fired by coal and later by oil, which became the most important commodity in our entire economy, and the fuel that fired the engine that drove the greatest period of growth in all of human history. We know this, but we've been walking on these exponential growth curves so long it looks like level ground to us, even though it's not. But the question here is not whether modern industrial society is good or ill, but rather, how long can it continue? Because we're already seeing breakdowns in some of the most basic systems that we depend upon for life, including our economy. Now, the problem here is not so much greedy bankers or Wall Street shenanigans or even our unprecedented levels of national and consumer debt, as much as it is our debt-based monetary system. For those who aren't familiar, money today is created in one of two ways, either as Federal Reserve notes, which are exchanged for treasury bonds and spent into existence, or as computerized loans, which banks essentially create out of thin air. The problem is that all this money is owed back to somebody with interest. So our economy must grow every year, and more money must be created as debt every year, just in order to avoid a financial collapse like the one we experienced in 2008. Meanwhile, global conventional oil production peaked in 2006. And while this doesn't mean that we're going to be running out of oil anytime soon, in order to keep up with surging demand from rapidly industrializing countries like China and India, we are turning more and more to unconventional sources of energy. These are mountaintop removal mining, tar sands of Alberta, hydraulic fracturing for natural gas, and of course, deep water drilling. But as we know all too well here on the Gulf Coast, these new fuel sources are much more expensive, both in terms of the cost to get them out of the ground and to market, as well as the environmental damage that they routinely cause. And to top it all off, even our climate is changing. Having raised atmospheric concentrations of carbon dioxide from 280 to 400 parts per million for the first time in several million years, we've already raised the surface temperature of the Earth by 1 degree Celsius. And while we can't say that any one weather event is directly attributable to climate change, extreme weather events like the Great Drought of 2012 are increasing. And all three of these monumental challenges are converging on this very point in history, a phenomenon that author James Howard Kunstler has dubbed the long emergency. But really, peak energy, climate change, and economic instability are really just symptoms of a larger collision of paradigms that is just beginning now. It's the paradigm of our beautiful, round, finite Earth on one hand, and on the other hand, the paradigm of endless growth, which requires more and more consumption of non-renewable resources every year, just to maintain our non-negotiable American way of life. Unfortunately for us, we forget that nature always bats last. So what do we do with all this disturbing information? Well, if you're anything like me, probably the first thing you'll do is stick your head in the sand and try to continue on with business as usual. I get it. It's easier. If you don't think anything's wrong, then you don't have to change. And sometimes just a shred of doubt can trump a mountain of evidence in regards to these crises we're facing. But as they increasingly impact our lives, we have to move past denial. So we accept that our world is changing. But we might try to console ourselves with the thought that somebody somewhere is going to fix it all before it gets too bad. And maybe it's possible. Maybe something we haven't even thought of yet will swoop in at the last moment and save the day. But that is a mighty big roll of the dice to be taking with the future of human civilization. So we see through the impossible dream. And we might feel like giving up. It's all too big. It's too complex. Too overwhelming. Why don't we just keep driving till we hit the wall? But if we can realize that we don't have to solve these problems all by ourselves, and that by doing so, we could actually find something that gives our lives real, meaningful purpose, we might finally open up to the possibility of transition. And I'm talking about transition here with both a little T and a big T. Both the international transition movement, of which my organization, Transition Sarasota, is a part, as well as the great transition that we are all part of, from a fundamentally unsustainable way of living to a more peaceful post-carbon society. So what does transition do, and how does it start? Well, it starts with a clear vision of the future we want to have. This here is a picture of a World Cafe discussion that we hosted last year on what an economics of happiness might look like for the Manatee and Sarasota County areas. Once we have a clear idea of what we want, the next natural step, of course, is to advocate for it. To go out there and try to rally as many people around our vision as possible. This is a picture of an event we did back in May with Hands Across the Sand and the Sierra Club, joining hands together at the shoreline to demonstrate our commitment to protecting our area's most treasured natural resource. And reskilling, relearning some of the skills that our grandparents or great-grandparents mastered in simpler and slower times. This is a picture from a workshop on backyard food production that we did. This is veteran organic grower Peter Burkhardt showing how to handle bees. But perhaps most importantly, transition is about practical projects. It's about creating the infrastructure for that future that we want to see. This is a picture from our Suncoast Gleaning project, which regularly harvests surplus produce from local farms for the food insecure in our community. To date, we've already harvested over 108,000 pounds of organic fruits and vegetables and donated them to All Faiths Food Bank and the Food Bank of Manatee. And some of our gleaners are in the audience tonight. But our biggest goal, and I'm announcing this here today for the first time, is to shift our local food system at least 10% in the direction of locally produced foods within the next decade. Part of the reason that we're doing this is a 2006 study that showed that out of the $800 million Sarasota County residents spent every year on food, 0.7% of that was bought from local farmers. However, the same study found that if all Sarasota County residents could spend just 10% of their food budget on locally produced food, that would add an additional $80 million a year to our local economy, potentially creating thousands of new green jobs. And we can do this. All it takes is going to your local farmer's market once a week, or planting a backyard vegetable garden, or signing up for a community-supported agriculture share. And all the information you need to do this is online at our Eat Local Resource Guide and Directory at eatlocalsarasota.com. And if you do anything tonight when you return home from this salon, I suggest that you go to eatlocalsarasota.com and take our 10% local food shift pledge. It really only takes a minute. Now, all this might just seem like a drop in the proverbial bucket, but when you're part of a learning network, international, with thousands of communities taking similar actions as we are, it really starts to add up. So I'm going to finish just slightly differently than how I began, by saying, may you live in interesting times. Only this time, not as a curse, but as a blessing, as the opportunity to speak to you here today has been for me. So thank you.